Next, we're going to talk about terminology, because understanding what it is that you're talking about when we're throwing around all these terms and how it relates to what we are looking at with the patient is important. It's great if you can diagnose aortic stenosis from a list of pressures, but do you actually understand how that is affecting everything else? So the first thing is what we've been talking about, hemodynamics. That is how blood flows through the heart. So hemo is related to heme, which is blood, and dynamics is movement, right? So thermodynamics, for instance, with physics. So this is the movement of blood through the heart, and it's related to a few different things. It could be an increase in flow, a decrease in flow, or maybe even the stopping or impeding of flow, like you'll see with aortic stenosis and coarctation. So that is a huge category of everything that we're going to talk about. And then you have the kind of subcategories of that. So preload and afterload are two that you might hear about a lot and you might not actually really know what it ever meant. So preload is related to ventricular filling. And that's a very basic way of, and simple way of saying it. But again, we're all about simple here in trying to remember these terms. So preload related to ventricular filling. And the actual definition of this is the amount of ventricular stretching that occurs. Let me catch up here. At the end of diastole. So remember, diastole is relaxation. That's one of the terms we'll go into in a second. So preload related to ventricular filling. And this can be affected by a lot of different things. So if you say, oh, I have an increase in preload, or I'm really depleted in preload, there's usually an underlying issue for that. And that might be related to some of these other things like compliance, contractility, pressure, heart rate, and lastly, venous return. The next one we're going to talk about is afterload. I guess you could say the opposite of preload. So preload is for filling and afterload is about ventricular contraction. Specifically, this is going to be about how much resistance the ventricle has to overcome in order to keep forward flow of blood. So normally blood goes from, for instance, left ventricle, LV to AO. So how much does the left ventricle have to overcome of force and resistance that's in the aorta to keep blood pushing from LV to AO instead of it coming back and pooling? And I'll show you visually kind of what that looks like at the end. My last little tip, if you want to think of it this way, is that preload is pre-ventricle and afterload is post-ventricle. So when hemodynamically, when we look at numbers and formulas, we're going to think about what chambers come before and after the ventricle that affect preload and afterload. The next one we've gone over in my first video, but pressure gradient, which is the difference in pressures really where there shouldn't be. And that's where we talked about aortic stenosis and that systolic difference. So then the question is, what is systole and what is diastole? Systole is contraction and diastole is relaxation. And during diastole, filling is occurring, and during systole, ejection is occurring. And again, that's really in relation to the ventricles. Next, we're gonna talk about hypertrophy and dilation. So in hypertrophy, that means an increase in muscle mass. And typically that's because of an increase in workload or an increase in pressure, just like when you're working out and you're building muscle. Now, if that increase in pressure happens after the chamber, so like after the left ventricle, what's going to happen? So if we had that high afterload, your ventricle is going to need to buff up or build muscle, right, to keep that forward flow and to open the door in front of it. So that is why you might see left ventricular hypertrophy with aortic stenosis, for instance. It needs to buff up to keep that forward flow. The second situation is, what if it can't? What if instead we retain volume because we're not strong enough to build up that muscle and we just kind of give up? That's where you might see dilation. So you're going to start expanding the ventricular cavity, expanding a space or even the atrium, and you're going to get an increase in volume. And when you get an increase in volume, like a water balloon filling up, you're going to get that dilation of that chamber cavity. Now let's take a look at what all of this looks like visually. So quickly, I'm just going to have my heart that I've drawn. I'm going to label out what I'm looking at because nothing matters if I don't know where I am. Okay, make sure you have a body and you have some lungs because that's important and you'll see why. So kind of where we start is where venous return in the SVC and the IVC. So the SVC brings blood in from the upper body, IVC brings blood, deoxygenated blood in from the lower half of the body. So now it'll go through the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle, through the pulmonic valve into the PA, go to the lungs, get oxygenated, right? And then oxygenated blood is going to come back to the heart through the pulmonary veins. Let me get my pulmonary veins in here. Into the left atrium, through the mitral valve into the left ventricle, through the aortic valve into the aorta, and then out to the rest of the body. So let's talk about our first problem. Okay, the first problem we're gonna have is in the tricuspid valve. So let's say tricuspid valve has a problem, all of that blood can't get through and can't go into the right ventricle because there's an obstruction in the door, right? Then what happens? Well, then you can go ahead and take away all of the other blood flow because if it can't get into the right ventricle, it can never go to the lungs. And as a result, you're gonna end up reducing how much oxygenated blood gets to the rest of the body. So even though you have, for instance, fatigue as a symptom or altered mental status, the underlying cause could have been tricuspid valve the whole time. So this is why hemodynamics is so amazing because you can really pinpoint the underlying cause and see how it affects everything else after it. Now, instead of how it affects everything after it, what if we had a tricuspid valve issue? How does that affect everything before it? So we're gonna have this increase of pressure in the right atrium, and what happened when it couldn't move forward? The right atrium is going to dilate, right? It's gonna increase in size because all of that volume is stuck there and isn't moving through into the right ventricle. So that's where you're going to see right atrial dilation. And there might be some other consequences of that and symptoms and signs as well. What if we also had an aortic valve issue? So same thing with the aortic valve. If there's a bunch of volume in the left ventricle that can't move, you're gonna have this increase of pressure in the left ventricle that isn't getting through. And eventually, sure, it'll buff up first and you'll get that hypertrophy, right? It'll increase in muscle mass to try to push against that valve to keep forward flow, but that only lasts for so long. So eventually that muscle is no longer strong enough to keep forward flow. And instead of hypertrophy, it's now going to migrate into left ventricular dilation. And you're gonna see that LV cavity get really thin and really large. That might be some of your dilated cardiomyopathy patients or your heart failure patients. So that's how the hemodynamics actually affects every chamber in the heart and why it's so important. So thank you for watching part 2, all about terminology with hemodynamics, and stay tuned for the next video.